Leader for the Southern Oregon Regional Schools Advisory Committee, I'd like to thank you all for being here for the inaugural meeting for our new regional leader, Alex Campbell, who has been working with all of the agency folks. But we very much look forward to our presentations and discussions today. I know that Alex has had a chance to network with the members of the council. So again, I think what we'd like to do is do self-introductions, and we welcome members of the public too who have come to hear an update on the regional solutions approach. And so why don't we go around the table this way? Alex, you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. Alex Campbell, Regional Solutions Coordinator.
Art Anderson with the Oregon Department of Transportation.
Steve Mason, I'm the manager for the WISE project.
Can you might explain what WISE stands for, just for this group?
Water for Irrigation, Streams, and Economy. It's a large, you'll hear about it later this afternoon.
Jonathan Belden, City Representative from Eagle Point.
Emily Mosca with the Carpenter Foundation.
Rick Dyer, Jackson County Commissioner.
Mary Baker, Regional Coordinator with the Infrastructure Finance Authority.
Kate Jackson, Department of Environmental Quality.
Josh LeBombard, Department of Land Conservation and Development.
Russ Stoff, Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife.
Good afternoon, Simon Hare, Josephine County.
Steve Rowe from Rowe Motors.
John Roberts, Oregon Water Resources Commission and Oregon Watershed Enhancement Board.
Peter Angstead, I'm with Rowe Community College.
Great. And Perimeter.
Beverly Layer, interested citizen.
Linda Acosta, interested citizen.
Okay. Tom Steen, same thing.
Colleen Roberts, I actually am a Jackson County Commissioner, but interested citizen.
And I'm Kenny Howe from the Illinois Valley Community Development Organization.
Great. Well, thank you and welcome very, very much.
We've got Annette Leva on the phone, and then Peggy Lynch, did you join us?
I did.
Great.
Great.
So Peggy Lynch with League of Women League of Women Voters, correct?
Yes, we
were voted
the
board. Great. And anybody else on the phone?
Yeah, good afternoon. This is Annette. Thank you for introducing me, Alex. I wish I could be there with everybody in person, but I just advanced from a cast to a walking group this morning.
Great. Annette's dealing with the medical industrial complex of Central Oregon, right?
Yeah, and of tourism and recreation.
Great. Well, super. Great. Anything else preliminary, Alex?
No.
Okay. What we thought we'd do first, since Alex is, even though he's new to his job, why don't you just give everyone just a little bit of background on how you ended up here?
Sure. Thanks, Bill. I'll say I was a researcher and policy analyst, or by profession. It was my first career in D.C. Moved to Oregon with my wife about a dozen years ago. I was really interested in getting more involved in local policy. So I did community development and economic development in the city of Milwaukee up in Clackamas County for about 5 years. And for the previous 5 years, I was running economic development for Douglas County out of Roseburg. And when Jeff was thinking about moving along, he sent me an email and told me that he thought I might be interested in taking a look at this job, and seemed like an opportunity to learn a lot of new stuff and work with interesting people, so I signed up.
Great. So, any questions for Jeff? Alrighty. Well, one of the things that Jeff did, of course, as our committee has evolved over the years, was that I guess a couple years ago we went through and determined some regional priorities. And of course, one of the great things that Alex has got to do is go back and actually see our record and where we have been, where we are, and where we're going on some of these different proposals. But this was again the priority list that we put together a couple years ago now, and maybe Alex, why don't you just run through that list just so again we have some sense of where we are, and then we can you know, ask ourselves, do we need to go back and do a reboot or an improvement or any changes to that?
Sure, great, Bill. So, I did put together a packet that I emailed to you. I think I've got a couple more if there are folks would like to see the list of projects that, that we've got related to the regional priorities. I'll give those to the part. But and one of the reasons I note that is I started thinking about putting them in order of these regional priorities. What I found was we've got a lot of them in a few number of these categories. So, and I'll sort of highlight as that we're going through the list there. So, at the top, we've got forestry management and ONC timberlands. We don't, in this region, not really working actively on any projects that are directly related to that that priority. Obviously, that's a lot of federal policy, so there's some reason for that, but it's certainly in terms of maintain and enhance forest industry infrastructure, you know, there's nothing that we're actively working on as a regional solutions team. Quite a few of the projects do relate to the next priority, business retention, expansion, creation, and recruitment, and we'll talk about a few of those today. Larry Holzgang, who's with Business Oregon, and is one of the folks who's most directly related to those projects, had to be in Salem today for a full department meeting, so sorry that he wasn't able to be here. But then regulatory streamlining would be another priority, and that's I think it makes a lot of sense given the history of regional solutions, and I think all of us as individuals often work on regulatory issues, but there's not a sort of large project related to establishing a programmatic permit or something like that that's related to that that we're working on currently. Water conservation, stream restoration, a number of our projects, the WISE project you'll hear some detail about today. Workforce training, our offices are co-located with the Employment Department and the Workforce Investment Board. But again, there's not a real project that we're directly involved there. Downtown revitalization, a couple projects of ours touch on that. Agricultural economy, a number of projects touch on that. Recreational economy, again, particularly the Gold Hill Whitewater project is very much related to that. And community infrastructure, working with, for instance, the Grants Pass Airport, I think is a good example of the kind of project that we're related to community infrastructure.
Great. So, still sounds as though we're basically on target, broad enough to touched on a lot of different issues important to the community. Anything we might want to think about taking off at this point?
I have a thought on a couple of things. I think the first two, somehow consolidating those, because I think they somewhat go hand in hand. If we don't have an expansion of the ONC, trying to, I guess, maybe they are separate, and I think we've probably had this conversation of why they are separate 2 years ago, but they, not to have forestry have too much of an emphasis, but it is kind of they should go hand in hand, because if we do have an expansion or the ONC federal legislation, which I think after this RMP has got a record of decision, they're gonna really be pushing on legislation. Senator Wyden said that really the only solution is, because everybody hates this RMP, is some sort of a legislative solution. But the real thing I wanted to talk about was the regulatory streamlining, and Josh could probably talk more to this, but there's the Executive Order 1207 that Douglas County, Jackson, and Josephine County are still working on. It's supposed to be done June-ish, and that's June-ish of this year. Just kidding, because it's been a multi-year proposed project. But that could probably have some element of land use streamlining for looking at those marginal farm and forest land. I didn't know if that could help with putting something, and it is something in Jackson and Josephine County that we are working on. It will require multi-agency kind of approval. Could be just something on our radar as a regional solutions one. But the main one that I was thinking about when I went through this list was the idea that internet, high-speed internet as an infrastructure component to the business retention, it's different than business retention, expansion, and creation. It's like a it's like an infrastructure element that a lot of our counties, either rural Jackson or Josephine, has developing nation style levels of infrastructure, and it's really impacting. I know this region has a significantly higher online based businesses or that are relying on that, and there isn't any one agency of the state to put that in their wheelhouse. It's not like you just give it to ODOT that says fix the transportation, the road, highway. Who do you give it to? It's in all of our wheelhouses, and some, but nobody's holding it, we're all holding it. It seems to get left off of these kinds of lists. So just a thought. Otherwise, I think the list is still on.
Good, Alex, a little research on that?
Yeah, absolutely.
I know that Steve Rowe, who serves on the Asante board, that a lot of emphasis has been placed the last several years on trying to connect the different practices throughout both Jackson and Josephine County, particularly the rural providers, on a system that was stable enough and had enough redundancy.
I'd say the redundancy is the big issue, because if you have one wire cut, sometimes that can really bring down the whole system.
So we wouldn't be adverse to collapsing some of these outlooks or maybe refocusing based on Simon's comments about making sure that we're in line, particularly with that.
You might even be able to, from a forestry standpoint, I'm putting on my ONC hat right now, reverse those two, maintain enhanced forest infrastructure. The ONC is an element of that component, because the private sector that has timberlands isn't necessarily reliant. They're not all the same. That's a pretty complex issue, but that second bullet, that's pretty comprehensive. The ONC is just a component.
Yeah, and of course, unfortunately, we've certainly seen some cause and effect with rough and ready's situation, and again, what do we do to keep moving forward on that? I know in our case, we do a lot of work with Fruit Growers Supply, who are probably one of the larger private landowners, primarily in Northern California, but supply a lot of logs into Murphy and Boise and everybody here, so get something to keep in mind. All righty.
What I emailed out to you all, I'm hoping to evolve with the team members into something of a work plan. I think that the piece that's missing currently is fleshing out a little bit more of these regional priorities, giving them a little bit more definition. I think, you know, Simon, your point that what kinds of community infrastructure makes sense for us to work on, and what the various agency relationships to those issues are. So that'd be my plan, is to bring back that a very similar list of priorities, but a little bit more fleshed out as far as how our team members relate to those priorities to share with you all.
Great. Alex, would be good to put Annette on the spot and have her just kind of give a global view as she's coordinating across the state, the different regional solutions teams, where she thinks proceeding, and again, our next agenda item, again, is how we want to communicate and work together, and for us to be a benefit to you. So, Annette, do you want to take the stage for a little bit and kind of give us an update from headquarters?
Sure. Thank you, Bill. I hadn't thought of doing that. So let me talk about some of the governor's priorities that I see as being relevant for regional solutions. The governor is, one of her, Governor Brown's priorities really is equity, and how do we make sure that underserved populations are represented in decision-making, state decision-making. And so one of the things that we're looking at for the Regional Solutions Program, whose focus continues to be economic development and job creation, but we're also looking at the advisory committees, the teams, and the coordinators. Are we reaching out to make sure that we're hearing from the folks who what we would describe are traditionally underrepresented or underserved? And how are we listening to what their priorities might be as we identify regional priorities? So that's, I think, a consideration. And I think, Bill, you and I talked a little bit about the advisory committee in Southern Oregon is whether or not there is an opportunity to have tribal representation, for example. So that's, you know, I will say regional solutions, the governor continues to be very supportive of it. It's a priority for her. Our focus continues to be on economic and community development, and we're looking to incorporate equity as a consideration in how we approach the work that we do. The other thing that I'll say is we are also want to make sure that we're thinking about small businesses. So I imagine that you already are, but small business support is another priority for Governor Brown that I see as having a very direct relationship to the work that we're doing through Regional Solutions. So, you know, we want to make sure that we're aligned with the Small Business Development Center and hearing input from small businesses. So that's another one of the governor's priorities that I think is directly relevant to the work of the Regional Solutions Advisory Committee and the Regional Solutions team.
Annette, I know that...
I'll stop there.
Annette, I know that it's for the governor, it's also important around housing issues. And again, we do have, in theory, the Oregon Housing Community Services represented on the Regional Solutions, but particularly since the legislature has and is allocating some money for low-income housing and different housing stocks, where do you see that playing out since it seems to be a rising issue?
Well, I would actually look to the region to help sort of shape and define what the housing issues and needs are. The governor's focus is really on the low-income housing. So there are going to be a series of regional roundtables that will share information about the new funding that the legislature approved, which is primarily for families at risk of being homeless. And I believe there's also a tranche of that money that it will be looked to align with the mental health issues and the housing needs of people who suffer from mental health challenges. So I know that that money is scheduled to be available from a bond sale in the spring of 2017. And that Oregon Housing and Community Services in the next several months is planning regional roundtables to share information about what the framework and funding is that's available to them.
So thanks for mentioning that, Annette. So Kenny LaPointe, who is with OHCS and is connected to our Regional Solutions team, is going to be in Medford on June 7th, 10 to noon. At the access offices to talk about those two programs that Annette just mentioned, those two new funding sources.
Great. So, Alex, what else do we need to, do we do anything else relative to operations communication practices?
A couple things I just wanted to let you all know. That one is that as a team, we're trying to touch base weekly on projects and just electronically check in on where we are on projects. I'd like some feedback. I did hear from a couple of you all that you thought that the advisory committee might be a little bit more functional, and not, I don't mean as opposed to dysfunctional, but more, maybe more effective if it was meeting a little bit more frequently than twice a year. So I'd be very interested in your feedback on that. And that raised a question about committee composition. So, I definitely want you all to have an opportunity to evaluate whether there were. I think if you all were to be interested in more committee members, it certainly makes the sense to bring on a few at a time. So, I'd be happy to do some work with you all about that. And then the only other thing I did want to mention is a practice that I'm going to borrow from. One of my compatriots is when we've got team meetings on topics that are particularly of interest to advisory committee members, I want to let you all know that, and so you can come and participate in those team meetings. For example, tomorrow we have our monthly team meeting, and one of the main topics we're going to be talking about is industrial land priorities for the area. But those are a few different topics that I just wanted to, you know, raise and see if there's any interest from the committee.
Well, Alex, you covered a lot. So you might want to break it down as far as
So meeting your frequency would be the, I think.
Makeup of the committee.
Yeah.
And then being made aware of the sub-team meetings, I think makes a lot of sense. I thought we were operating on a frequency of quarterly, but it does feel like it's been just twice a year. I don't know. Maybe that.
That's my understanding. That has been pretty much the practice. So
it might have been more frequent when we were trying to get the prioritization or the projects list kind of solid before the legislation, and maybe we had more then, but it seems like it was more frequent than just twice a year. I think quarterly probably makes sense, especially if we're being made aware of the team meetings. That's really where the work gets done. We just kind of need to set priorities and make sure things are kind of on the queue and get the broader. That's just my thought. That more than that may get duplicative, because some of these projects are so multi-year, there really isn't a whole lot to update until the legislation passes. Your bonds in the 17-18 get funded, you know, it takes a little while.
Yeah, I think maybe, Alex, you know, thinking of the legislative calendar is something, and you might want to work with Annette and your other folks on, is there a sequencing of input that would be valuable for us, particularly as the governor prepares her budget for the upcoming biennium, as to where are the points of that you'd like to have input from us relative to going forward. Again, we're working our way through the first biennium, where we also were allocated resources that we were allowed to prioritize, and so that's a still pretty new work in progress, but again, where that fits into the governor's perspective with her budget for next biennium, I would say would probably increase or lessen the need for more meetings and when we need to give you a thought.
So can I jump in here and maybe provide a little bit of feedback on where we're at with that particular issue? This is Annette.
Okay. Please do.
So, you know, last biennium, we had a number of challenges as in how regional solutions priority projects were brought forward. In particular, we had a mix of lottery revenue projects that were not capital projects, and then we had lottery bond projects, which were capital projects, and we were more successful to secure funding for the capital projects. But one of the things that I did after the session was to talk to the conveners of the Regional Solutions Advisory Committee, several advisory committee members, and heard a lot of feedback from legislators as well, that what we're hoping to accomplish with this upcoming biennium is a process that will look more like Connect Oregon, where we actually will ask for an allocation of funding for 17-19. It's likely to be a capital request. And then projects will be identified after the legislature has adjourned and the funding amount has been established and we can allocate it amongst the different regions. So rather than having projects identified, you know, 2.5 years before the money's available, we'll be actually doing the project solicitation after funds have been committed to. We're in the process of working on draft rules for what that will look like, and I anticipate that those draft rules will be available probably later this summer for people to take a look at and for public comment, that will kind of set forth the framework for how those projects are going to be selected moving forward and recommended by advisory committees.
Any questions, comments on that?
So, should we move on to project updates?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's always a fun part of the meeting.
Well, My thought was start out, give you an update on the Whitewater Park, and then Russ was going to update you all on the related conservation project in that area of the road. And then I'll turn to Mary for updates on North Valley Business Park, the Food Hub, and the Grants Pass Taxiway. Kate's going to update us on the Little Butte Irrigation Pod project. Josh is going to talk a little bit about Novalis. And Commissioner Hara, I thought you might want to give folks an update on where the Dimmick redevelopment.
Oh, sure, absolutely.
And then I'll close with a couple pinch hitting for Larry. I imagine you all saw on the agenda, we're going to have a significant amount of time to go in depth on the WISE project, and that's why Steve's here. As far as the Gold Hill Whitewater project, they did apply for Oregon Parks and Rec funding. The city of Gold Hill applied for an Oregon Parks and Rec grant. The design of their, or the updated design about of what they're planning to do there came in close to the that deadline, just before that deadline. So there are a couple issues with their application. One is they didn't have a fully formed funding plan for the larger, the project. The in-water work has swollen, I guess might be an analogy, a little bit. And they also, there is, as at the time, undetermined ownership, whether the waterway there is navigable, whether that's DSL property or not. They did not, with the application, have DSLs written, any kind of discussion about a lease agreement. So that part, that application is not going to be successful, which I think is fine. I really encourage Steve to do it as a practice as much as anything else. It would have been the time frame or the construction would have been really tough to meet. But as I said, some more design work is coming in. We had some discussions with Russ and another one of his compatriots in his office locally. They've got some concerns, I think it's fair to say. We're going to be going up, a couple of design members, and Steve Kiesling and I are going to go up to Salem on Wednesday. We're going to have one large meeting that is about 10 agencies that get together monthly to review projects in sort of a intense manner. And then Russ was able to set up a follow-up meeting with a couple of fish biologists and a fish passage specialist, so we can continue to flesh out which parts of these projects are going to be ultimately permittable, so they don't spend a lot more time designing the ones that may not be. So that's a quick update on what that is. Russ, did you want to talk a little bit about the ranch?
Yeah, so Bill asked that I update the advisory committee on a project that's not been on the docket for the regional solutions team as of yet, but it's associated with Oregon Community Foundation, so Bill's familiar with it through his association with them. It's the short story on it's pretty long, so I'll try and give you the really short story, because it's quite a back story, but it involves a local family, the Mace family, and many of you probably are familiar with the Mace family here. Bob Mace, who was born in 1921 or 1922, his grandparents actually had homesteaded out on the Rogue River on High Bank Road, so just across Jackson County off of Kirtland Road, just upstream of the confluence of Bear Creek and the Rogue River, immediately across from Lower Table Rock is High Bank Road. In a really unique area of the Rogue River, there's a high bank there that's a bedrock escarpment, and Sam's Valley's on the north bank of the river, and then as you get down below that escarpment, at High Bank Road, you drop into where Gold Ray Dam was built, because you're at this kind of nick point in the geology there. Bob Mace, he had a career with Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife after he grew up here, graduated from Oregon State University, met his wife there, did a career with Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife, retired in the late 70s. Although he was a wildlife biologist, he retired as our deputy director for field operations. And he was a visionary in that he understood the value of wildlife that people view, that people don't hunt or angle for, but, you know, bird watching, other values surrounding the species that we don't actively manage for consumption. And it irked Bob, I think, back in the day to no end that we, by default, refer to those species as non-game, because the other ones are game. And so we just thought, well, logically, we'd lump those into non-game. So Bob is credited with coining the phrase watchable wildlife shortly before he retired. And it became a very popular term. And it's employed around the country and around the world, actually. And I think it irked Bob to some degree. I was fortunate enough to get to know Bob when I first got to the Upper Rogue Valley. I was in Gold Beach in 03. Bob didn't pass away until 2006. So I got to know him a little bit. He was, I think, concerned that my agency didn't adopt that moniker, watchable wildlife, and he wanted to immortalize that and contribute to Oregonians in the context of that resource. And upon his death, his wife Phyllis and him, they made three gifts to Oregon, and one of them was a $1.5 million donation to Oregon State University School of Wildlife for a Watchable Wildlife Foundation scholarship for undergraduates. He gave $1.2 million to Jackson County Expo to build the Bob and Phyllis Watchable Wildlife Memorial Building, the newer building at the Expo that if you go to the fair or any functions, it's the one air-conditioned newer building. And he also, and more importantly probably than the other two, as important as they are, he had a third gift for Oregonians, which the money that Bob amassed in his life, he of course didn't accrue working for the state, where he had some business ventures and some other things going on. And Bob, there is 165 acres of his family property down on the Rogue River at the end of High Bank Road, on the High Bank. Bob realized that the highest economic value of that resource, that property, was aggregate mining. That was zoned for aggregate in the first comprehensive plan for Jackson County. It's ideally situated off of Kirtland for construction in the area. And so Bob set that up. And he also understood that, and it's not river associated, it's on this high bank, so it's all upland. So Bob set that up through Oregon Community Foundation, and then Knife River subsequently purchased the mineral rights, and that's now their primary source for aggregate. As they mine it out, a royalty gets paid on every ton of rock that goes to Oregon Community Foundation to be managed within an advised trust fund. And I'm one of the advisors, along with Bob's daughter and then Bill Levins, who's a local person that many of you know, who's involved with the aggregate industry. That is to be managed in perpetuity, the revenue from that, through OCF for watchable wildlife, really in the property area, but in the surrounding Jackson County Road, possibly down into Josephine County, and ultimately as we do projects. But primarily, the original focus is for the property, and upon mining out the property, upon reclamation, I was fortunate enough to help the family develop the vision of what this would be, and it will come into Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife's ownership as part of our wildlife area. But it will be, we'll roll in some adjoining properties, it will be a 150-acre, 60-foot deep quarry pond, if you will, lake, perched on this high bank adjacent to the Rogue River with 1,000 feet of river frontage, which is an old-growth cottonwood gallery immediately across from Lower Table Rock. Cow Creek Tribe now owns the property across the river. We can reclaim that along the model of some of these ponds that have been reclaimed in the east, in the south, and in the UK, where they manage them very well developed for recreational opportunities. And so we would have a very enhanced day use area for people to boat, non-motorized boating, angling, watchable wildlife, hiking and viewing, with both the river frontage and Whetstone Creek, offering watchable wildlife components and natural habitats, if you will, to complement this very recreationally intensive lake. And to sort of cap that off, that's totally dependent upon the economy, how quickly that develops and is mined out. It's likely to be somewhere between 15 and 20 years. The trust fund is likely to accrue between $7 and $12 million, depending upon the economy. We'll have grant monies associated with it, you know, on the order of whatever the revenue off of that is ultimately. And then what the family and I have done since we last spoke with Bill and updated Oregon Community Foundation, we have formed a nonprofit foundation, the Watchable Wildlife Foundation, so we can receive grants from Oregon Community Foundation to develop this property. And we are very interested in developing it, not only as the site itself, but in the context of this reach of the Rogue River, which now that Goldberry Dam is removed, you've got Tuvel State Park, if you will, approximately on the upstream end, where Table Rock crosses the river, all the way down to Gold Hill. The city of Gold Hill is, you know, arguably the least developed, most natural-oriented reach of the Rogue River in the upper river. It's the only reach where you're not sort of feeling like you're in somebody's yard when you're out there. And that's a 18-mile stretch of river. We're interested in working with Jackson County. We've already begun to do that. Several other players to develop a comprehensive plan for that reach. And the whitewater concept for the city of Gold Hill, of course, fits into that. And I've been speaking with the city of Gold Hill, as well as Steve Kiesling, about that broader context. Finally, to cap that off and take any quick questions that you've got, Bob was very visionary in understanding the value of watchable wildlife and what that means to a local economy. In 2008, Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife partnered with Travel Oregon and contracted Dean Runyon Associates in Portland to do an economic evaluation by county of Oregon. I mentioned this the last time I was with this group, and you can find it on our website as well as Dean Runyon. And just call me at any time if you're interested in this. But they estimated the value of the all associated expenditures related to hunting, angling, and wildlife viewing by individual counties throughout the state of Oregon. In 2008, wildlife viewing generated $21 million in revenue for Jackson County. And, you know, and arguably that would have been a low year with the recession and, you know, some other factors involved. So it's got tremendous potential, and if anybody ever has questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Looks like an exciting project, huh? And the county also, I think, continues to look on the Table Rock side of the equation, too. But like you say, what an amazing corridor to be working on. So.
Yeah, we're excited. There's a lot of potential.
Super. Thank you for the update.
Mary, do you want
to? Sure. Go ahead. Okay, the first of the three projects is going to be the North Valley Dental Services District project, which is funded by our agency and with county funds at this point. And I don't know if I have them around to everybody. I apologize. I didn't know how many people were going to be here. Right now, our agency provided $60,000 worth of funding from the Special Public Works Fund, and the county matched it with $40,000 of their own funding to prepare a preliminary engineering report to take a look at some solutions for the North Valley Industrial Park and its wastewater issues that it's having. It needs to expand the park, but the wastewater treatment provided by the Fleming School is meeting the need right now, but the current plant facility is needing some repair, upgrade, or replacement, so things need to change at this time. So we have funded the preliminary engineering report. And by the way, I want to say that the report which I handed out was prepared by Robert Brandis of Josephine County. I'm going to give him credit for preparing the report. He put it all together for you. And anyway, they contracted with Civil West in the fall of 2015 to prepare the preliminary engineering report. In May, the report was 65% complete at this point in time. It's still a pretty rough draft. It's only 65% there. But they, as a result of the 65% complete report, they're discovering that it appears the packed bed media filter system would provide the cheapest treatment alternative to serve the area. However, they're not sure of the exact location of where the drain field will be, so they're having to do soil samples and analysis to see what would be the best site for that. There are several alternatives that they're considering at this point in time, and they were out last week taking the soil samples on that with DEQ. So hopefully they'll know fairly soon which site will be the best for the drain field on there. And the county is also working with taking a look at operation and maintenance expenses to see which one would actually serve the best in the long run in terms of meeting the school's needs too. Because we also have to take a look at the school's cost to currently operate and maintain their current system versus joining in with this larger approach. So Robert is working on that. I know last week we had many emails going back and forth. He's taking a look at the numbers. And then we're hoping that Civil West should have a 95% complete preliminary engineering report by the end of June. That is the target date. So at that point in time, we'll all have a little bit more information to work with. But right now, that's the quick snapshot. Any questions? All right. You guys are an easy group. Okay, project two is in my next area here. This is the Fry Family Farm Food Hub. And this one here, Josh, Alex, myself, Patricia Foley from the Rogue Valley Council of Government, went out and took a look at the site. Now, I have pictures to share for you here. The prefabricated structure is up. They have the kitchen is under construction. You'll see in the pictures there. The large walk-in cooler, and I do mean large walk-in cooler. I can't remember how many square feet it is. Do you remember, Josh?
No, it was big though.
It's huge. It's ginormous. It is in. The freezer, the walk-in freezer is there, but it's not installed. The hoods for the kitchen are in and are sitting there on the floor, the one picture where you take a look on the inside on the front cover. They have the one fire hydrant needed for fire suppression is installed, and they have 8 tanks that they have to put in and fill up with water for their fire suppression system, and I honestly can't recall how big those tanks are.
They were 5,000 gallon tanks, so 40,000 gallons.
So, and then, let's see, the hydro cooler is not in yet. They're still working on that. But the good news is they are 2 weeks ahead of schedule. They're hoping to have this project complete by mid-June. And overall, the project is moving along well. And I'd like to give also thanks to Patricia Foley from the Rogue Valley Council of Government, who is the recipient of the funds from the Regional Solutions Team, because she helped prepare this report for you all and helped with some of the pictures. So. Any questions on that one?
Boy, you're just moving ahead.
You know, don't like to mess around. Got too much to do, everyone does.
I think most of the advisory committee members are well aware of it. For those of you who may just learn something about this project, I think it's important to note the money from the state is going into the portion of the processing facility that will be available to multiple growers.
So you really think that mid-July it'll open? They're 2 weeks ahead of schedule. I think they will be open by then. Wow.
Yeah.
I didn't have all this help. Okay, the last one on the list is the Josephine County, or the Grants Pass Airport, Eastside Parallel Taxiway, the half-parallel taxiway extensions, 2,000 linear feet. And again, I'd like to give the thanks to Larry Graves, the county airport manager, who helped put this information together for you all today. As you probably are aware of, there is the incidents where airplanes are having to, or traffic is having to cross the touchdown zone of the runways, which is causing a safety hazard. And that's the reason for the half-length taxiway. At this point in time, they do not have any funding yet for the design and construction, or excuse me, the design, environmental, and permitting of this project. They are coming to our agency to get a special public works fund loan to prepare all of that while the RST funds become available in 2017. At this point in time, they're coming to our agency for $344,400, and about $75,600 will come from the county, and then that'll prepare the $420,000 project to do the environmental, the permitting, and design for this project. They already have matching funds secured through the FAA, a total of about $2.1 million, so all we have to do is get the project design and the environmental complete. Last week, on May 12th, exactly, the county actually submitted their pre-application to our department for the SPWF, Special Public Works Fund Loan, and I'll be working on that tomorrow when I get back in the office. So this project is moving ahead quickly, and once it is done, it could have a really beneficial impact to the whole entire area because it'll open up additional hangar locations, and there could be an additional 35 to 40 jobs created once those hangars are built and occupied. So it could have a real beneficial impact, not only safety for the airport, but also job creation.
Well,
We want to thank Simon for his work on raising this issue, and quite honestly, this is a novel approach towards airport work. And so, Simon, thank you. And do you want to add anything about how this, having regional solutions gave you a vehicle?
This is not a typical regional solutions kind of a project. It isn't something that the county has just general discretion dollars. We would have had to contribute all of our economic development funds for an entire year to do this project, or at least this phase. And really, this was the thing that got the FAA kind of woke them up to the idea that this is that important, that regional solutions, the state's going to step in. I know it caught some legislators a little bit off guard, maybe. Betsy Johnson and I had a conversation about what this means as far as long-term implications to the regional solutions funding. And when we could sit her down and tell her how these dominoes are set up with this kind of an outcome, the nice thing is all of them fell exactly how we wanted. The construction time for the FAA has moved up. The funding is there. Mm-hmm. And frankly, now we're waiting on this element.
Correct.
Whereas before we were waiting on the FAA.
Hey,
now they're waiting on
now
us.
FAA moved it up a year.
Yeah. So it worked out.
Now we really have to get moving.
Yeah. Right? It was
yep.
kind of funny the way this all just fell into place. So thank goodness, because otherwise it wouldn't have looked as good as it does now. So it's also gotten other things in the queue when we do the expansion of the Eastside Taxiway. It's moved up the time frame for a runway extension. So we need another 2,000 feet on our runway.
Yeah, this
which
is just a half extension here. Yes.
This is just that's the entire, like the full mm-hmm. runway. So we're going to need to do that to land larger planes there. We have over 200 private airplanes that are based out of the Grants Pass Airport. So I know there are alternatives to Medford's airport, Ashland and others, but that's more than Medford's private airport, private airplanes.
In Connect Oregon 6, you have a request for auxiliary power?
Yes, both of our airports don't have backup power generating facilities. So we've got an AWOS system going in this week, right now. Larry Graves should take all the credit for somebody who's taken these airports that have kind of, I'd say they languished for the last decade or so before he got there 5 years ago, and really just stepped up. I couldn't even tell you all of the things that are happening at our airports. It's pretty tremendous. So,
does he coordinate with the Illinois Valley?
Oh, tremendously.
Oh,
we have two airports.
I'm on the advisory board for the IV airport.
IV is doing a lot of things as well. It's amazing what success gives you. Other challenges of adequate fuel. So we've got that as a key issue. They're having to fill up the 5,000-gallon aviation fuel, one of the tanks, twice a month, maybe almost once a week. It's not very efficient. We need a larger tank out there. It's just one thing after the other, but it's good. They're all good problems to have.
Okay, if any of you have any questions, don't hesitate to contact me. Track me down, okay?
Well, none of this would be able to be possible without that interim funding, which I'm really glad to hear the state is addressed. These projects needed to happen, all of them needed to happen yesterday. And so when you apply for that last bit of money that makes it happen, but you have to wait 2 years, that isn't really meeting the need. So I'm glad to hear the state's.
Well, I think, again, that speaks to also having all of these agencies working in conjunction, that they have different resources that they can draw upon.
Absolutely.
Which I think, again, and plus good working relationship with our legislators, who sometimes can find other ways to fund programs too. So, but again, it's definitely around the entire loop on it.
Yep.
So,
Kate,
yeah,
yes, the Little Butte Creek Irrigation Project, you had an update at the November meeting, and that was the meeting at which the distribution of the funds was decided. So that project is eligible for about $230,000, but we did not find an interim funding method for that. So they're waiting for that to come more than a year from now still. Meanwhile, they applied for both of the newly available Water Resource Department and OED funds this year. And,
excuse me?
Yes, Annette?
Can I ask you to move the phone a little closer to Kate, please? Thank you.
Yeah. that better?
You're down in South County now.
Thank you.
The Little Butte Creek Irrigation Project qualified for, was going to receive $230,000 from the advisory committee funds. And at their report in the meeting in November. And they did not pursue an interim source of bridge funding, but they have applied for other funds from both Water Resource Department and from OWEB. And those funds have only just now been awarded. Just last week, we learned that they got almost $73,800 from OWEB to match their NRCS funds and the other sources of funds they put together. And that would actually be Jackson County, Jackson Soil Water Conservation District is receiving that funds on behalf of the project. They are also up for an award from one of the Water Resource Department fund decisions that are going to be made this Thursday. And that one is to, that one they did not make the cut. They asked for $149,000 and did not get that one. But it's just an illustration of there's many sources of money. The state of Oregon has these additional new sources that are about water conservation, water development, water quality improvements, but they're very competitive. That project is moving along to the extent that they can, and they find other match funds to go with the NRCS funds, which is their primary source.
Josh, you want to talk a little bit about Novalis? Just to preface Josh's comments, that we as a team had a pretty lengthy discussion about this project in April, and I think the conclusion of that was, as a team, we agreed that made sense for us to continue working on the project, but we did want to make clear that work didn't necessarily imply an endorsement by the state or the governor's office that the project in its proposed form was a good idea. What we're going to do is help provide technical assistance to figure out if it's a feasible and logical project. So.
Yeah, thanks for that. So I don't think we've talked about this before at the advisory board. So this is a project, you might have seen a recent article in the paper maybe 2-3 weeks ago on this. Damian Mann wrote an article about it. It's a proposal to place, the proposal was for a 500 student college campus. It's about 10 miles southeast of Ashland off of Buckhorn Springs Road, which is off of Highway 66 as you kind of pass the last arm of Immigrant Lake out there. It's a complex in kind of controversial project, a 500 student college campus in a very remote area of the county is something that's has land use issues, but then there are other issues with it. So that's kind of why we had that conversation at the RST at our team meeting, is to talk about what it means to be on the RST list. Does it, you know, connote some kind of endorsement of the project? So what, like Alex said, what we kind of determined was it doesn't mean that, but what it does mean is that we will provide assistance, especially with a project like this. This is very multi-agency oriented. We've got potential issues with ODOT, with Department of Environmental Quality, with septic and wastewater. ODFW is involved because it's in big game habitat range. So these folks have submitted an application to Jackson County. It's with the planning department right now. The initial application was, I guess, rejected is a term to use. The county responded with quite a long list of additional information that it felt it needed to be able to process the application. The consultant for the property owners responded with some additional information on that, and then since that submittal, there was that article in the paper which sparked some interest, to say the least. So what's happened is quite a few different folks, not just neighbors, but community members, have come out with some concerns, and it seems like at this point the project, where the property owners are going to reduce their proposal from 500 students to maybe somewhere between 50 and 100, which is probably more fitting, you know, with that rural environment, but it's still going to be up to the county, the Department of Development Services, to process that. It goes before the Planning Commission and then to the board for decision making. So we'll be involved, we'll continue to be involved with it since it's multi-jurisdictional or multi-agency project, and kind of see what happens at the county level.
Do we know about how many, you know, they have that shared program up in Lincoln, right? The college just uses part of the property up on the top of the Green Springs. Do they run about 50 to 100 students there, do you know? I'm just curious.
That's a good question, I don't know.
Could you remind me when and how this particular one got on our list?
And Alex might be able to help, but talk about what gets put on the list, but this was before Alex, so I can kind of speak to it a little bit. So what happened is the consultant for the project, he's a land use consultant that represents various folks in Jackson County, he brought this.
Who was that?
Dan O'Connor.
Okay.
So Dan O'Connor brought this to, he set up a meeting with me and with Jeff Griffin about it, and I think it was, he was doing his due diligence, you know, trying to check in at the state level, you know, to see what kind of feedback we would have for them. And knowing that there were some pretty significant ODF&W or potential ODF&W issues, we brought in Ross and his staff to basically do a site visit and walk around the property with them. So I think because of the how interesting the project is, I mean, what they're proposing is, you know, the sustainable agricultural and, you know, forestry type of college campus. I think Jeff saw some of the benefits in maybe putting on the list as far as trying to help streamline some coordination.
Well, can you remind me when that was?
I bet it's been on the list for 9 months.
Related to that question, we spent some time as a team sort of talking about that question, sort of how do we put projects on the list, and basically what I said to the team is that I would bring, not for a vote or anything, but that I would raise new questions with the full team at a meeting before we quote unquote put them on the list, just so that, you know, folks, all the team members had an opportunity to give input.
Seems like a good idea.
Learn as you grow type of thing.
Of course.
So I don't want to belabor that, or maybe this isn't the time, but at some point I think I would like to discuss how things get on a list. I'm affiliated with this, and it's a nice thing to have a conversation about a Jackson County focused project that their planning department, so it's not me, but if it was my county department that said no to something and I'm on this and it's on my list or our list, that's a little different. It doesn't mean that these agencies can't work on that project, because you're going to probably regardless, but does it have, you know, the buy-in? Is it potential to receive funds? It seems like a conversation that I would like to have. I don't have a decision right personally, but I know which direction I'm leaning.
Kate?
And from one of the state agencies' perspective, DEQ is, and all of the ODFW are two natural resource agencies that have representation on the committee here. So when something comes to my attention as part of the team that I know involves other agencies, I would prefer to be allowed to do that outreach and see what's there and see whether it's coordination or information or more technical staff to bring in. So it's a really pertinent question about when a project becomes a project.
Well, remember before Regional Solutions team were created, that there was some mechanism within the state for as an issue like this coming up, but it was very much just agency to agency to agency discussion. And again, I think that part of the rationale behind this was, well, let's create a little wider informed group of the public and people from other municipal or other governmental agencies to link into this, because I think, you know, that was what we were hoping to do, was to, as a public member, to be able to support the work of people like Alex moving forward. So as it migrated up to Salem, he could also bring some additional perspectives to the table.
I wonder if, to address Commissioner Hare's point, one of the things that we talked about as a team was maybe not a complex system, but some sort of tier or category of project, where there's a project that the team's, you know, helping the advocate consider if it should move forward or how could it move forward. If there's a project where it's moving into an implementation phase and we're actually talking about the team actively working to support a project. I mean, I think, for example, the projects that you all have determined to put money in, the Regional Solutions money in, clearly the advisory committee is in support of those projects. But it's probably important to make a distinction between those two different kinds of activity.
I think, for one thing, that's really important, because to me, this is on a list of things that we've looked at really, really carefully. And we haven't really looked at the Novalis project, at least this group hasn't looked at it particularly carefully. Others we've put funds in because we think it's really important things to go forward. So it would be nice to have a division between those two categories, I think, from my perspective.
I appreciate you raising the question. I think an endorsement is implied when it's on the list. From my perspective, if my board saw this, we've talked about it, an endorsement, if we didn't have the money, we didn't have the money, we would have liked to, but or whatever. But an endorsement, I think, is implied for some project, whatever it is, being on the list.
Sure. So I guess what the way that occurs to me to sort of skin that cat is to basically have a list that is the advisory committee's list that you all have signed off on, and then the list that's the team's list that the team is working on at a technical level, that, you know, and so we're making clear that the advisory committee has not necessarily provided an endorsement of that.
That sounds perfect, because I think we could have different tiers all over.
I mean, I think it's interesting for us to know what you're working on in terms of projects like this one. But that is still a different category of something that's supported.
Right.
And maybe I'll chime in too with land use issues. It's kind of a different animal too, to a certain degree, because it's the local jurisdictions that have the ability to approve or deny something. We have appealability over actions at the local jurisdiction. So there's kind of an inherent conflict to a certain degree, not to say that we can't take on land use projects. I mean, my department is part of the Regional Solutions team. It's just that there are some potentially inherent conflicts there.
I endorse it, because when I was talking with Jeff Griffin last year, what are those regional challenges that were, a lot of them are around land use, and I don't necessarily want Regional Solutions to say maybe that the medical marijuana or the recreational marijuana is an endorsement, but it's a challenge we're both dealing with, and how do we employ all of these different teams to come to the table, from state land use to water resources to all sorts of stuff, transportation, infrastructure. I don't know, but that doesn't mean that I endorse it. It's just, here it is, we got to try to figure out something. And that's probably, Jeff provided some pushback, which I think was justified. I'd have done the same thing in his role. That doesn't make it go away. It doesn't make it any easier for Jackson County or Josephine County having to try to work through these complex new issues. But if it had, it was on the list from a team perspective, but not the other, that would be great.
Right, well, it sounds like maybe a conversation we can continue, and I can bring a proposal of what appears to me to fall into those two categories and touch base with you all. Commissioner Hare, did you want to give us a little update?
Yeah, there's not much to, I mean, there is. It's a positive first step forward, having that building removed from the campus. If you'll remember, it's at the intersection of A and Dimmock inside the city limits. It's the old hospital, the old hospital campus site right now. Public health is there, our planning and building and safety departments. But our plan is, and what we did a few months ago, is hire a contractor to come in and kind of facilitate the redevelopment of that 6.22 acres. And they'll be kind of reaching out to the senior transitional housing was the transportation growth management grant that the city facilitated as probably the best and highest use, conforming with that neighborhood. So it would be a combination of high density residential and senior living, also with community. We could move a library, our library up there. So it would be a pretty multifaceted piece of property, and we're still working with the city on what that looks like in order to achieve those high density residential. We may have to do zoning elements, and we're working on a grant to do remediation on the remaining buildings right now, so that it's pretty much shovel ready, whether it's to somebody would want to level all of the buildings, they're all clean, or keep them, they're all clean. Either way, we need to do that. And so yeah, that's pretty much where we're at right now. It's pretty positive. We're looking for some sort of movement. If we feel like the timing is right, we have a pretty high occupancy rate of the senior care facilities within Josephine County, and that population is our largest growing segment of our population as they age into needing smaller and more care, and wanting to stay in the community is a big part. So the proximity to downtown and all that.
Yeah, Steve just turned 60, right? So
we need to get
quite yet. Halloween.
Well, with the way things go at the county level, we hope to have it available.
I'm just getting started.
20 years.
80 is only a number.
20 years we'll have it. Yeah. Hopefully sooner than that. So that was it.
Perfect. Thank you. So on behalf of Larry Holskin, I did want to just let you know that he has been working a lot on the Spalding Industrial Park, and there was some interest in that. In one of the parcels that could be developed to expand the park. So he's hard at work with them. One project that had been sort of on the list for some time that we hadn't been in touch with is went by Project Thermal on the list, and it's the farming fish operation. They do aquaponics, so they're both doing aquaculture and hydroponic vegetables in a closed loop system, so the fish are fertilizing the vegetables, and the vegetables are cleaning the water that goes back to the fish. Josh and Kate and I went to visit them about last week, and they are the early stages of the project that the Regional Solutions participated with them on was looking at potentially some geothermal or other sources of renewable sources of heat energy, because that's one of the most expensive inputs to their process. They're raising tilapia. They have to be kept warm. And they're also raising lettuces and basil, and those need to be kept warm as well. So they have a partner. That they've identified a heat source here in Jackson County, some waste heat that they think they could co-locate with. They've got some pretty ambitious plans in terms of the amount that they want to expand as they move into that next phase. So we're going to put them back in touch. They already were in touch with the local angel investor group. That group's evolved quite a bit, and I think they've evolved quite a bit as well. So it might be interesting for them to re-engage with them. They are working with Oregon Department of Energy, who's helping them design the heat transmission system. But I think they're a point that we probably do need to continue to stay in touch with them and see what we can do that to help them along. Because they've got, as I said, pretty ambitious plans, but they're making some really great steps as far as the business operations. They're developing some more products, pesto, for example, that will really allow them to smooth their demand versus versus market. And so it was exciting and encouraging. That, I think, is 2:15. Steve, we've got Steve Mason here, who's been involved with the WISE project for a number of years. It's one of the projects that clearly is of great significance that Regional Solutions and Oregon Solutions has been really involved with, and is moving into a new phase of work. So we invited Steve to come talk about what the status is really currently, what are sort of the real hurdles or barriers or steps that need to be overcome moving forward. And Kate and I also have talked about that this might be a great group to help us think about public communications around the project and at what point and what needs to be shared beyond the stakeholder community that's really around the team. So, Steve, do you want to talk about
it? Sure. So some of you know this project, and then if this worked very well, slide. It was working for you earlier.
Yeah. So I should probably back and forth to keep it from
going
to sleep.
Okay, like I said, some of you know this very well. In the simplest terms, it's an infrastructure rehabilitation project. The idea is looking at agriculture here in Jackson County, specifically the Bear Creek Little Butte Valleys, and trying to find a way to make sure that ag economy remains viable in the long term. To do that, we looked small, then we looked large, and we came up, for example, with some basic goals. We want to improve the in-stream water quality, the temperature, the amount of flows, but at the same time, we want to make sure that we're improving the irrigation water reliability and availability. And that includes both storage, it's 7 reservoirs in 3 basins, in a sense, as well as the live flows.
What's the difference between availability and reliability?
So availability is beginning of the season, how much water do you have? So you get, for example, your water right almost generally, ubiquitously, it's pretty much 4.5 acre feet per acre. So at the end of the season, that's how much water you're allowed to have used. In general, they get closer to 2.5 acre feet per acre right now, basically because of the system. The reliability is currently the districts that we're talking about operate. You get your water every 2 weeks, depending where you are in the system. When you get into a drought system like last year, that can get reduced down to every 3 weeks, every 4 weeks, depending on what you're growing. That makes a big difference. And you can have that season shut down early, or we got lucky, it was a very wet year here, we were looking at maybe not opening. So that's the difference. So one is the total amount of water, the other is how your access to that water, how available it is to you.
And all of the above.
So, and I'm talking quickly, but please do interrupt as I go along when you have questions. So it is a pretty good-sized area that we're talking about. It's mostly this Bear Creek Valley. It includes some of the Little Butte Creek Valley. Within there, there's about 35,000 acres of lands that are irrigated through this system. It does include reservoirs that are in both the Rogue Basin and the Klamath Basin. Water is taken from Little Butte Creek across the basin over to Klamath and then brought back down again. It's a very complex system, and unfortunately, that's part of the difficulty with the project is the infrastructure. There's about 300 miles of canal, 250 miles of canal, and an additional 250 to 300 miles of laterals. Lateral being a much smaller, goes from a canal to the farm in most cases. And throughout that system, all the streams are used to convey water, which causes issue for wildlife habitat and so forth, and water quality. So the idea with WISE, I have to shrink it then before I can do that. Okay. So what we wanted to do to be able to meet those goals is we need to find more water. Well,
there's not really more water there. We have to be more efficient with the water we have, or use some of the water that we haven't been using. So piping and lining the irrigation canals. That's the main thing here. And like I said, we're just talking about improving the infrastructure, rehabilitating it. Most of these canals are 100, 120 years old, they're earth lined, and they lose around 30% of the water that's moved through them. And most of that loss is through leakage. If you piped everything, the estimate is you could conserve around 40,000 acre feet of water, enough to fill underground. It's a lot of water. That water would be available for drought protection and improving reliability as well. And there's other benefits to go with that, and I'll talk about that in a second. We looked at reservoir storage. The difficulty with that is the hydrology to support increasing the reservoir capacity, and it doesn't really exist. Agate, you can do that with. It's the smallest. It's only 4,500. But based on cost benefit and so forth, we're not looking at including that component right now. But pumped water, though, on the other hand, does become and still seem to be quite beneficial in the area. So we're looking at the regional wastewater reclamation facility. That's the treatment plant. The water from six of the cities, the sewage goes there, they treat it, they put it in the Rogue River. Well, during the irrigation season, that water could be treated to a higher level, and then it wouldn't have to go into the river. That would reduce the demands on the treatment plant's permitting process, so there's benefits there. And that is about 12,000 acre feet of water. Again, about a third of what's in Emerald Reservoir. That's a good amount of water. Currently, Ashland has their own treatment plant, and that's about 2,000 acre feet of water during the irrigation season. That's already dumped into Bear Creek. And it's quite clean. It's cleaner than Bear Creek.
Steve, would that help to mitigate the temperature?
That's, so one of the issues, currently they do have their NPDES permit, and temperature is the biggest issue, but right now it's only an issue mostly on the end of the summer and then in October. And that's part of the work I believe City of Medford is doing with the tree planting work as well. Let's try to mitigate that. If they don't have to put it in the river, there's, you don't even have to, the problem solved. And it's much cheaper, more effective, efficient to pump and use the water like they do in other parts of the country significantly than it is to cool the water. So it seems to be a win-win situation there.
Why end of October? Because the season, the reservoirs are lower.
And the river's lower, okay. And the temperatures in the river are a little warmer and so forth.
That makes sense. Yeah.
The other source is Lost Creek Reservoir. And so the if we go back here, the bottom of the system, the Rogue River comes down here. We're talking about putting a pump station where basically Gold Ray Dam used to be. It would allow us access to a couple sources of water. One is we can allow flows to bypass the system, go down Little Butte Bear Creek, irrigation flows, have benefits to the streams, more flow, keep that water cooler, benefits for the habitat, and then pick it up and pump it back into the bottom of the system. So there's some multi-benefits there. It also would provide access to Lost Creek water. Right now, I think there's 26,000, 28,000 acre feet of water still in Lost Creek that is allocated for ag use. And so on a drought protection, that would additionally help extend drought protection from this 1.5 year safety that we have out beyond 5, 6, 7, 8 years. That would be a great benefit for the protection for depending on what you're growing, especially if it's grapes or trees. You can't miss a year because if you lose your plants, you're out of business. So, there we go. Works the same way. So in general, the idea of the project is pipe where the canals are. We did look at, and we are, I don't want to go too much, where it makes sense, alignment would be changed. We've been working with development community and looking at areas where we can straighten the canals. The canals were built, they have to be built almost level, they have to follow the contour. And so what we would do is where we could, an example might be, for example, right here. A pipe does not have to do this 1 foot of elevation drop per 1,000 feet. It can do whatever it needs as long as the bottom's lower than the top. So we could straighten it there. In the end, it looks like we could save 10 to 20% of the cost of the materials just by doing that. The idea then, though, is we would also straighten it out, especially the laterals, so that the system is not cutting across tax lots. It's going along property boundaries, right-of-ways, and so forth like that. That provides a lot of benefit to the development community and so forth. Property values are more valuable if you don't have an easement and a pipe that you have to deal with right through the middle of the property. Other than that, we're also talking about, and all the tributaries, no longer diverting water. All of them currently do. We would leave those waters in stream. They would all make it down to Bear Creek. Those diversions would be removed. So there's a lot of benefits to the in-stream habitat, like I said.
Is there any problems long-term-wise with the earthen dams? There's leakage along the way, but people may come to depend on that inadvertently, not knowing that that water goes away for them all of a sudden, and they through habitat or whatever.
Yeah, so there's two. We'll talk about it here. So there's, I'll talk about the issues first that you brought up, and then I can talk about the benefits, leaving you with a better taste in your mouth.
Well, I don't bad taste in my mouth.
So, no, that's actually a curious question. So one is the leakage that's coming through the canals. The other is the overwatering and so forth that goes on. There's a lot of that number being 1 to 1,000 to 10,000, we don't know, shallow wells out there, for example. Those are hand dug wells. They're not accessing groundwater. They're accessing, in this case, surface water. So there's going to be, there's a suite of ways we can deal with that. The simplest is, if you're doing irrigation, we can address that. That's the simplest. Most likely, you're probably already within the irrigation district. But if you're not, we can try and bring you in. We can give you access to the water directly through the pipe. If you're using the water for domestic use, and you'll know right away, because your well, before April starts, there's no water in it, or the water level's low, and then when the irrigation season starts, whenever that seepage fits, again, that's surface water. If you don't have, your well does not have a right to that water. A well has a right to groundwater. So we would then look at, and depending where you were, whether drilling a new well, there's a public safety, health safety issue there, the quality of the water. None of the water in the canals, especially the lower you get in the system, is high quality. So we're looking at solutions for that in particular. And then how you apply the water would change depending on the soil conditions. The idea is, and these numbers are just one model run, it's a lot of water that you can serve. It's about 30,000 in an average year. So it's the 22 number is a dry year, like a drought year, an average year, and then a wet year. We're in an average year right now. So a lot of water, not quite enough, two-thirds, three-quarters of enough to fill Emigrant. They would be just conserved in an average year. At the same time we shoved more water to the farms. We thought that was important as well. So again, this is just one model. One of the things that's most interesting to me is it's a gravity system. So we have about 1,100 feet ahead. So throughout the system, there'd be building up of pressure. A lot of the irrigation use would have the water then under pressure. If you wanted to water by pressure, you don't have to, you can still continue to flood very simply. A lot of that pressure would be available to you. You may either not have to pump as much, or you may not have to pump at all. The other thing that allows for is, if you look at the bottom list, hydropower generation. So we're determining what that amount of that is. If you're already moving the water through a pipe downhill, there's an opportunity to generate hydropower, and that becomes a big part of looking at trying to fund this thing long term, as well as running that pump station on the Rogue River. The other thing it does is it, from an irrigation standpoint and ag standpoint, there's all these benefits of when you get your water. Instead of getting it every 2 weeks, most locations you would get it daily or on demand. Worst case is probably a short rotation, 3 days, 4 days, something like that. And that makes a big difference of what you want to grow. And even if you just want to grow pasture, and I don't mean that as a negative, but if you want to grow pasture, you should be able to get a thicker crop and maybe a second cutting, an additional cutting as well. The numbers that SWCD put out doing this throughout the state and out the west generally improves your production by about 30%.
Steve, as you're driving down 199 at Savage Rapids, you look over and you see the pump complex that was put there for the Grants Pass Irrigation District. On a scale, what would
a 10?
Much smaller.
Oh, really? Yes. So we're not talking that amount of water. I don't have the numbers yet. We're going to be doing the preliminary design. That's on the last slide here. We'll be starting that next month on that. So I may be underestimating that. Maybe it's half that size. Because, again, we're not going to pump the water up to Medford or Talent or Ashland. What we do is the water that was going to come down, we'll pump up to the bottom and less water within it. In-stream benefits, additional to those, more water's left in those streams. Some streams would go dry later on in the season. It'd be a more natural hydrograph. You do have the ability to open a faucet, if that's important, potentially have water stored in the reservoirs for fishery benefits. The water should be cleaner, colder, and there should be a lot more of it. And perhaps more importantly, the streams will operate at a natural sense in that at the bottom of the system more water, top of the system less water, and then it goes down throughout the season. Currently, that's not how water in Bear Creek works. You can go out there and then 10 hours later, if there's no water or there's twice as much water, and it depends where you are in the system. It's just how the infrastructure is used to move irrigation water. That goes away.
Stephen, the last iteration, again, we made quite a bit about the federal benefit for the Klamath salmon area, right? Are those numbers still holding up relative to if we can increase the efficiency of our systems here? Water?
I'm not sure I understand the question. I want to make sure I answer it accurately.
As I can remember from my memory, that a lot of the cost benefit for this project from the federal standpoint of kind of reaching critical mass was on if we could better maintain the rogue system dumping into the ocean, that had a tremendous economic value, national economic value for the Klamath coho.
Yes, so the rogue coho is very important to this ESU, the SONC. Is that what you're talking about? Okay, so the rogue and the Klamath are the same coho. This is a huge part of that. Partly because the South Fork Little Butte Creek is one of the main strongholds for coho production in all of the Rogue River. I wish Russ was here because he's the one that would answer this most accurately. So this is, if not the biggest, it's one of the biggest water quality projects the state would be doing. It had the biggest impact regionally here on water quality, and it affords the irrigation community to get disconnected from that, which is a big issue for liability in the long term with regulatory. We're already dealing with the regulatory impacts of having to release water that normally would go to irrigation to help offset those impacts. This would look at addressing those. I don't know if I answered that or not. So there's a lot of the in-stream benefits, like I said, and what we're looking at doing with these water rights, one of the main benefits is converting them to in-stream rights, which is valuable, but converting these older water rights to in-stream water rights. Currently, the oldest are in the 1970s. Most of them are in the 90s. In other words, you can't enforce them from a seniority priority date. These would be some of the more closer to the 1915, 1922 dates, and actually then we can guarantee that some of that senior water would be left in the stream. That has benefits also to the municipalities where there's more water and cleaner water, and suddenly that can become part of the city's use, how they want to use it, whether we're here in Medford and then we're over at Hawthorne Park, having the stream actually, instead of the sign saying don't touch E. coli, it actually be part of the activities. We didn't talk about it, but recreation's a big part of this. We're looking at improving recreational benefits up at the reservoir significantly. The idea is we draw down the reservoir significantly slower. We want to have them at least half full. That's not usually the case. And there's a direct relationship for the county. All the fees to run the park system
pay for the parks. And so the idea is that if, and we see this, the more water there is, the more people use it. It's a direct line. As the water levels go down, people use it less. So the higher we can keep those waters, the more we can provide access to that. And then just real quick schedule there, I just wanted to focus on 2016, what we're doing now. We're trying to dovetail everything, so this time next year, everything has come to a point, and then we have the answer, because again, we're in the preliminary design phase and the environmental development phase. By this time next year, we'll have the cost of the project officially, we'll have preliminary designs, we'll have the water rights solution, we'll have the funding and financing plan, and we can say this is what's being proposed, and everyone at that point can say yes or they can say no. So what we're trying to do is make sure by this time next year we can provide all the information to everybody so they can make an informed decision and decide how they want to go forward with the project. Including the governance, the benefit sharing is making sure that the public gets an equitable amount, enough of a benefit to that. How much water gets left in stream, when does it get left, that's very important. Especially since we're looking for public involvement in this project from the state and the federal government. And just for those that don't know, the feds own over 50% of the infrastructure that we're talking about. Bureau of Reclamation already owns most of that infrastructure, including all the reservoirs. So when I'm talking federal, that's the pie that I'm talking about there. And John, I talked as fast as I could. I saw a timeline on that one.
John, I mean, it's pretty incredible. How much further you've gotten? Just in the thought.
And Bill, it's really thanks to the WISE project and to the advisory committees. The very first time you had an opportunity to endorse a project, you dedicated all $2 million towards the WISE project. It is that state funding that is paying for all of the work the Bureau of Reclamation is doing, and the work that Steve is doing with TID and the other irrigation districts. And the
wise
board.
Well, it's such a critical project for the whole community.
I think the maybe the silver lining of the drought for the last several years has been an awareness by the greater community of the need for something like this. Because if we hadn't been fortunate this winter, we would have dry land farming going on. And this will add a significant buffer to that that water supply.
And you're gonna keep Steve involved for a while?
Hope so.
I don't have it on here, but if you go to the website, wiseproject.org, my contact information's on there. Alex has it, so if you need that. In fact, Mary and Kate, everyone seems to have it now.
Feel free to call. It's on the new website.
It is on the website. I find the project interesting, partly because I feel that the open spaces and the ag and the recreation are important reasons why this area is, we like it so much here. I believe this is one of the potential solutions towards that. The difficulty, of course, is the complexity of it and trying to plan long-term, something you guys all do on a day-to-day basis, but working with this long-term development, because Jackson County is growing population-wise. When these things were built, the population of Jackson County was right around 8,000 people. And since then, a few people have moved in, and so those canals have different impacts than they did when they were first built. And so,
I have a couple of questions and comments. I think when I first heard about this project a couple of years ago, I honestly wasn't terribly excited about it because of what we in Josephine County had done. It's not sustainable to be pumping that volume of water every year. It just seems fairly ridiculous, the price tag on the electricity that they spend alone. And then what I see, the water being used and how much you said is lost. You know, you're losing 30%, but you're pumping 100%. 100%, but this project, I can't thank you enough for bringing that. You've answered so many of my questions. It seems sustainable. It seems like it covers all of the bases that makes a lot of sense. One of the things that I'm dealing with in Josephine County and all municipals across the country are, is this element of drainages being utilized for storm drain, storm runoff. But if you pipe it, I don't have access to it necessarily anymore for stormwater runoff. And there's this non-point source pollution that's an issue. It's really complex. And so in order to move forward, somebody's got to kind of work all of these bugs out before anybody else is going to go anywhere near it to touch it.
So I have two comments there. The first one is, on the pumping one, what's interesting, currently there's zero pumping within the system, and that's important, the gravity feed system.
Right.
Once the project's done, there doesn't have to be any pumping in the system either. The pumping provides additional sources of water if wanted. The idea then is that the hydropower would pay for any additional pumping that you wanted.
Yeah.
So it's to provide that buffer zone at the end of the drier years. On the stormwater, that's a huge issue. I know it's a system, and it's an issue not just here in the Rogue Valley, Jackson County. It's an issue throughout the West, anywhere where irrigation has been developed, because lowland farming is also where development occurs. It's just the best lands where people want to be. You're invited, or I will invite you now and then make it official later, anyone you wish to send. Part of what we have to do as we work through this next phase of technical work is the cost estimation. And to do that, we need to know where we're going to put the pipes. And what we're trying to figure out as part of the stormwater component, because here, these canals are all used to move water, and most of the time, it's become de facto part of that stormwater system for the municipalities, not just the cities, but the county as well. Mm-hmm. So what we're doing is we have a stormwater subcommittee, a wise stormwater subcommittee, I should say that. And we're going to look at which reaches can we actually fill in and no longer leave open as a canal, and then which reaches do the municipalities need to have to continue to operate the way they are. We do not plan on having, as part of WISE, a need to develop a new stormwater infrastructure. The reason we want as many places as possible to fill it in is it's least costly to put the pipe in the canal. The next level to do it is either under the canal or next to the canal on the right-of-way. So that's the plan,
sure.
Is to maintain that. Then the third part of that is then, okay, now you've got these. You no longer have to use them to move them for irrigation. Is that the time to officially get the easements to say stormwater delivery on there? Most of those easements only say irrigation.
Right.
And is that the time to begin and develop a stormwater district or a very a contractual relationship between the irrigation districts who could continue to manage the canals between those and the municipalities? So we're developing that as part of the engineering.
Yeah.
So you're right.
Who pays for all of that, and then who's cost incurred?
Exactly.
It's really challenging.
Exactly. And the thing is, it has to occur, because at some point, if you don't pipe, in the long run, you're probably going to run, and GPID was a good example of this, where the effectiveness of the irrigation district goes down, and at some point there's a threshold you meet where it doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
And so at that point, you're back to the stormwater. If the districts aren't going to maintain those canals, are they going to go away? And the cities then have to figure out that solution.
Yeah.
So whether you do it now or 50 years from now, at some point this answer has to be come to. And so WISE is using this as a focal point to bring a spotlight to that. And if you would like to send anybody, just because I know you guys have some.
Yeah, if you wouldn't mind letting me know, I can find somebody to send. That
can
would be
you
really.
Forward that information?
I probably won't be able to make it.
That's fine. I understand that, but there's technical.
I find
staff
it interesting, but I don't have the.
No. You did technical staff.
I know water runs downhill. That's about it. That's about it.
I just wanted to underscore the need, because we have a barn that has ditches in it that were built in about 1921, and it leaks all over the place. We have water that just flows out into the middle of pastures that we just can't control, that the ditch, that the MID can't do anything about. So this would just be an incredible godsend to the entire valley and the agriculture that we need to keep here.
Rick, any perspective from how you're scoping this whole?
Well, I mean, I'm very interested in the project. I'm learning more and more about it, and obviously there's concerns that we have, but you know, the more I learn about it, and the more I see, you know, the benefits and how
how they are substantiated by what you said. I'm open to learning more and more, and these sessions like this really help.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And let us work this space up.
Yeah, I think so. It's, you know, we weren't sure on the AV if it was going to, but I'm very impressed. I like this.
But before we let you go see that, there are obviously a lot of technical hurdles that still remain. There, and there's going to be a huge political hurdle of the funding solution. Are there sort of political hurdles between here and there that bodies like this need to be aware of and, you know,
yeah,
and helping formally bring pressure or support or whatever the case may be?
Well, it turns out that the answer is yes, obviously. So as Commissioner Key said, stormwater actually is a political hurdle, whether you form a stormwater district or not. That is one. The shallow well or the seepage issue, how you deal with that, that is going to be, to some extent, potentially that as well. In the long run, I think it's going to be the funding and financing. We're trying to do this so there's as minimal impact, if any, at all on the individual. We're trying to make this project self-sustaining and so forth. But those are the main ones that I see that we're going to have the most pushback against. Usually putting a canal in a pipe, I can deal with most of the issues that come up with that other than those three. The cost, the someone who's been getting the water that they're not in, they don't have the water right to, and then the storm water. Those are the three big political issues. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Steve, do you want to mention the water rights grant application that you've got in?
Yeah, so we'll find out on Thursday. We did put in a water rights. We'll find out Thursday. We put in a water rights grant application. Currently, the water rights, it's the most complicated system in the state to run these 35,000 acres. What we've done is we put in some funds to get some funds that would allow us to bring on a consultant to figure out how you could use those water rights to run a system like this with the changes we're proposing. Whether it's contractual water for reclaimed effluent or Lost Creek, whether it's changing PODs, whether it's converting. First question is, can you? The answer, I believe, is yes, but this will confirm that. And then the other one is, how could you do that? We'll know on Thursday, and if so then we'll move forward with that. And by the end of the year, everything, like I said, we're trying to dovetail it so we can put it before all the stakeholders, in particular the ones that are the landowners, the water owners, the county, the districts, the cities, give them all the technical information they need. Yes, Commissioner?
So on your application, is there going to be a public comment time?
There, on which one? The
water right application.
I believe that there was. It was 30 days.
It passed already.
I believe it
passed.
Oh,
you already applied for it.
Yeah, that one we did already apply for. It was the 1069 funds to OWRD water rights. So there was a public comment period that went out.
Yeah, it closed. I mean, the commission's going to consider that grant application along with about 20 others on Thursday.
Yeah. And Jackson County and Jefferson County were well represented with the grant applications down there. And they all went to a public comment period.
And they've gone through a regional review team and recommended or not various grants and then followed by public comment. So they've been pretty thoroughly vetted.
Did you get public comment? I wasn't aware of that.
I don't remember any public comment from the usual commenters, such as Water Watch. They were okay with it.
I mean, just the general public, not
organizations. Yeah, no, I don't remember anything in correspondence that I've seen came back.
That might be available through the website. Maybe not yet, but the water resources, there are.
I just saw it today.
Yeah.
And there was nothing.
Great. Thank you very, very much. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me. And again, any questions, just call me directly.
So we have a public comment period. So if there are any members of our guests or anybody on the phone who would like to make any comment, I think think statutorily it's particularly related to the priority, the adopted priorities, but imagine there should be open to hearing.
Oh, this is Peggy Lynch. Thank you for letting me listen in. I always learn things when I listen. Thank you.
Super. Thank you very much. So, Alex, welcome.
Thank you.
And again, great meetings, great information, great progress. And we will continue to work on improving the communication loop. And we look forward to working with you and the team. Art, anything from transportation, since we hate to just...
Hey,
one of the most popular guys in Southern Oregon.
We're not doing anything. You can see what we're doing.
Well, this has been a nice repass for you.
Exactly. I was like, hey, I'll take it.
Great. Alrighty, well, we'll be in touch with you. In the meantime, thank you very much. And again, we will be working with Alex on the Community Capital Committee if we need to add anything. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to say Robert and Larry are graceful.
Yeah, they are. Yeah,
they are.
No.
Blessed to have Larry.
Oh, man.
And all the